And that brings us to Meniere's disease. Everyone know what Meniere's is? As you, certain circumstances, or as you grow older or postmenopausal, women's or men's balance goes a little awry. You feel dizzy, you feel vertigo, you feel nauseous, you get migraines, and this sort of stack of conditions is called Meniere's disease, and that's related to balance issues in the year, in the inner ear. So this is the structure of your ear. Your ear takes in sound from here. The sound hits this drum called the tympanum, and there's three bones, malleus, tapus, and incus, that sort of leverage the sound and turn it into electrical impulses that go into your inner ear, and from the inner ear it goes into the brain and it gets translated as sound. So that's what's happening every day. If this is inflamed, or if this is inflamed, or if this is inflamed, you have issues. And so you see these three things? Those are called the semicircular canals, and those are responsible for your balance. And we'll walk through what those are because they're super, super important. So this is your ear. Messages travel through here. They hit the tympanum. These are the three bones, the malleus, incus, and stapes. And it hits your inner ear over here. This is called the cochlea. This is what helps you translate the sound into nerve impulses, electrical impulses, and hear the sound. But over here, you have these structures called the semicircular canals. And these are super, super important. And then things drain from your inner ear through the eustachian tubes into your nasal area here. And frequently, when you have infections, you drain from here. So it could be infections that cause problems here as well, or allergies. But semicircular canals are incredibly sensitive things. And this whole structure is located, it's called the blood ear labyrinth. So there's a barrier between this and the rest of the body, and it's called the ear labyrinth. And it has a number of membranes that are critical in maintaining the homeostasis in this organ. And if you blew up this previous diagram of that into this, you would see that this is the area where you hear. So when deafness happens, frequently on a low insulin diet, people start to hear again. But this is where your balance happens. And what this structure is a bunch of ducts. On the outside, there's a fluid, and there's a membrane here. Between the green and the yellow, there's this membrane. And this part is called the endolymph, and this part is called the perilymph. The endolymph is structured. The fluids there are like the inside of your cells. So you have a lot more potassium than sodium. And you have an 80 millivolt charge here. And they have shown with experiments that if you put insulin here, too much insulin, the charge disappears. And without the charge, you can't have balance. So these are the very, very sensitive radars that allow you to balance and not have vertigo. So this is extremely energy intensive. This little thing consumes three times the oxygen and energy that an equivalent amount of your brain does. And when it doesn't get the energy, when you're in a hyperinsulinemic state or there's too much insulin, this potential, this 80 millivolt potential decreases and you get vertigo. And a lot of this research was done in the 60s by that guy I sent you the video of, Dr. Brookler, who was an otolaryngologist and he was a surgeon and he made a lot of money from surgery, but he put himself out of business by putting people on a low carbohydrate diet and their balance, nausea, migraine, hearing problems just disappeared. Mm-hmm. What he noted was that 98% of the people who came to him with these problems had hyperinsulinemia. They were either type 2, type 3, or type 4, phase 2, 3, 4 of insulin. Mm-hmm. And the second he put them on a low carbohydrate diet, those problems just disappeared. He didn't have to do surgery. The problem was, this was in the 70s, when the food guidelines said that fat was bad. So if you can't eat fats and if you're on a low carbohydrate diet, you're eating nothing, basically. You're not getting your energy. So these were people who did not find their lives pleasant. They would eat just enough carbohydrates to survive, but not so much that they got an insulin response. So it had to be very closely managed, their diets. But we have since learned that fat is not an awful thing. It is part of a very important macronutrient, and people that are put on this kind of diet have dramatic changes in many areas of disease.
How much does it affect thyroid?
A lot. Thyroid is affected incredibly, suppressed. Thyroid hormone is suppressed by hyperinsulinemia. So this is just a picture of the perilymph and the endolymph. The endolymph has this, it has a positive 80 millivolt potential. It has more potassium, potassium than sodium. And the perilymph, which is the outside, is a lot like your cerebrospinal fluid. So these two fluids don't mix up. If there's a hole in here, you will just be constantly dizzy. If there's damage here. Now the other thing is the bones. The bones in the ear are very, very sensitive, and they're harder than any other bone in the body. And what insulin does to bones is it dissolves bone. So insulin works with your skeletal system. The skeletal system serves as an endocrine organ, and it causes the osteoblasts, which are the things that cells that make bone, to get suppressed. So if you take the insulin resistance out of the picture, the bones in the ear get stronger, the potential gets maintained, and frequently, or in a lot of these cases that these doctors assessed, the vertigo improved dramatically.
So you said that insulin dissolves bone, so is insulin also a culprit in terms of osteoporosis?
Yes, exactly. And you find that hyperinsulinemia, when it's taken out of the picture, bone density, and especially the elderly, postmenopausal elderly, increases rather dramatically. So these two are very different fluids with very different electrical potentials, and that is what causes you to be able to balance. You will find that when you are fasted, I don't know if you've done this test or not, and if you stand on one foot in a fasted state, you'll be able to stand for a lot longer because you have no insulin in your bloodstream. Try that experiment. I did very poorly on the test, but the second I started fasting, I can stand on one leg for a very long time. And that is to do with balance. That is to do with insulin resistance in your inner ear and bones. So this research was going on in the 60s and 70s and 80s, and now with the new ENTs, it has just disappeared. So you have to go to the old literature. Kraft and a fellow by the name of Jerry Raven from Stanford and this Brookler, and you find that there's a lot of literature on diet-induced changes to vertigo and inner ear problems.
And there are interviews and videos online,
yes,
and YouTube with these doctors.
Yes. That's just a bigger picture. And so what does insulin do? It regulates something called osteocalcin in the bone, and the bone actually serves as an endocrine organ. So the bone is not as dumb as we think. It's not just a piece of a pile of minerals. The bone has hormones. The bone interacts with insulin. Insulin causes an impairment in your insulin signaling, which is impaired, causes bones to dissolve, meaning the osteoblast to stop producing bone matrix and the osteoclasts to accelerate bone destruction. And so this sort of brings up the point of the human body is designed with no redundancies. Every system is responsible for a bunch of different things. And we have become too reductionist, too mechanistic, where we think that your skeleton is responsible for just hanging your body on a frame. It's not. It's a lot more complex than that. The bones around the inner ear become very weak. You have thyroid abnormality from insulin resistance. Infrequently, vitamin D, increasing vitamin D, really accelerates balance improvement. improves balance. So if you have balance problems, just focus on reducing the insulin levels, get a lot of sun, get vitamin D supplementation if needed, and just sort of see, test yourself by standing on one foot and see if there's improvement in balance over several weeks.
I'm just curious, if the thyroid, I'm talking because I have somebody that had the thyroid removed, which I disagreed with, but anyway, she claims that there were some, they found some growths.
Yes,
cancerous.
Not cancerous.
Yeah, so will this cause the growths, do you think?
Will it cause the growths to grow?
The growths on the thyroid.
Thyroid is very affected by insulin. So higher insulin levels will cause cancers in various, and the thyroid is very, very susceptible to insulin levels. So if you take the insulin levels, insulin out, your thyroid is not suppressed anymore. So that your BMR actually, your metabolic rate actually goes up.
If you eat plenty of vegetables,
mm-hmm.
but your protein amount is a little too much,
mm-hmm.
because I find it very hard to keep just down to, say, 3 ounces
mm-hmm.
of salmon, for instance.
Right.
Yesterday I bought a piece of salmon, it was under a half a pound.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, well, I'll cook the whole thing and eat just half of it. Well, I ate the whole thing, but I had, that, does that immediately cancel out the
no.
benefit?
No, proteins have salmon has a lot of fat in it, so you've got a, I would say, 80% fat meal.
Okay.
Salmon is very high
I
fat.
See.
You eat it to your satisfaction. But what I'm saying is you don't have to force yourself to eat a lot of protein to think you need
yeah,
protein
right.
to get fat.
Right. Well, my trouble is
mm-hmm.
I tend to eat salmon and maybe tuna or something and chicken.
Yeah.
But I tend to eat more than 3 ounces
That's
of
okay.
it at a time.
That's okay.
As
yeah.
long as I eat lots of vegetables
yeah.
with it.
Lots of vegetables
yeah.
and with lots of fats
yes.
and sauces on it, and we'll make a sauce at the end of this.
That's okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So eat it to your satisfaction. Your body is your best guide
yeah.
for how you want to eat. But what you want to do is anyone with many Aries, test it, try it. Eat in a shorter window, so there's fasting in a longer window. Test yourself for balance in the fasting window versus the eating window, and keep to a relatively low carbohydrate diet. And it's very delicious. It's not
I have
much.
Another question. If you eat grapes or something
mm-hmm.
after your meal, does that immediately cancel out the good that you've done?
It doesn't immediately cancel out the good you've done, but it's a carbohydrate. So it's up to you how many carbs you choose to eat. But reducing, and remember, vegetables, you're getting plenty of carbs in your vegetables.
Yeah.
Above ground vegetables. You're still getting carbs. You're just not getting a whole bunch of carbs. But if you want to eat a couple of grapes, go for it.
Well, I just find I find after dinner, you know, I'm trying to stay away from any chocolate covered cherries or anything like that. But I find grapes are kind of a good substitute. But I tend to want to eat a whole cupful.
Right, right. So you wanna limit the sugars
limit
a little
more.
Bit. And part of the problem
yeah.
is habit.
Yeah.
Once you start eating more
class.
Fast, they will satisfy you more. And you'll get into the habit and you won't even notice.
And are you saying basically you can't eat too much fat?
You can eat all the fat you want.
Oh, okay.
All the fat you want, you can't eat too much carbohydrate.
Right, right.
Okay. So breads, pastas, rices.
Yeah, I've stayed away from bread
dry
and
fruits,
pasta and rice
fruits,
at all. Yeah.
They all have fructose, and fructose is very toxic to the liver. And this is for people who have insulin resistance or who suspect they have. So I'm not advocating this for pregnant women or children, but for people who may have insulin resistance.
It's just so hard in the summer to give up fruit.
Yes,
you know,
yes.
The fruit is so wonderful
yeah.
this summer.
Part of the problem is insulin resistance is actually a not natural phenomenon made exactly for this purpose, to tank up in summer so that in winter you're burning off, your body eats all the fruits, feasts on the fruits, you become insulin resistant, you store them as fat, and then in winter you burn it up. But right now, in today's world, we have 365 days of summer. And
yeah.
so you're eating fruits all year round, you're eating eggs all year round, you're eating this, that all year round, and you will become substantially insulin sensitive if you become seasonal, which is you only eat those things in season and then don't eat them at all. And you eat just those. So in summer, there's not that much fat. But we eat fats as well as fruits in summer. So we're mixing carbs and fats and causing insulin resistance. Whereas in winter, people tended to eat animals, which are fatty, but there was no carbs. So you ate either fats or you ate carbs, but you didn't eat both.
So is it easier for our bodies to digest one or the other? I mean, if, for example,
yes,
with
yes,
the example of the grapes.
Yes.
So have your meal and then have your grapes
3 hours
later.
Yeah, 3 hours later.
So
separating
them would be separating
ideal.
Separate them.
If you're eating starches and fats, at least separate them by 3 hours.
Well, by that time,
you're
know,
gone
I'm
to the world.
It. Yeah,
yes,
it's just after dinner, I want something.
Something. And you know, if you're eating a cup, eat a couple. A little something won't hurt you.
Yeah,
you know?
Okay.
Or you can have a carb window and a fat window.
Yeah.
What you're doing when you mix the carbs and fats is the body's gonna deal with the carbs first. The carbs are toxic. So the body's gonna take those carbs and convert them into fat and push them into your fatty tissue or into your liver. And then the fat that comes in is automatically going to be stored as fat. Whereas if there was no carbs, there'd be no insulin. And if there's no insulin, you're going to burn fat. But the insulin acts as a gate on all fat stores. So eating a carb with a fat is going to cause you to not let the fats out of the fat cells or your liver.
Where do you determine the 3 hour period?
That's roughly the time it takes for the carb to be metabolized. And for insulin levels, you're hoping that in 3 hours your insulin levels decline.
So you're saying, though, I could make a meal out of grapes?
Yes.
That just be
a small meal out of grapes. Or in your snack time, you could eat grapes. And the other times, you could eat a fatty meal.
I
so
see.
You have fat, carb, fat, but not all at once.
Right. Okay.
The way nature intended.